our focus for this session. I want to welcome each and every one of you in this session that will talk about crop production and the research work that the IRC does in the area of crop production. I'm not going to say too much because we've got a few speakers here this afternoon that will enlighten you on all the research work that we are doing. And I also want to just request the speakers to keep to their time. And whilst we are changing the presentations and the mics, we will also do the question and answering session. So welcome, and I hope that you enjoy the session with the IRC and enjoy the journey that you will be presented. Thank you very much. Our first speaker is Dr. Ian Leploy. He is from this institute, and he will talk about the establishment of agricultural enterprises for sustainable rural development. This is work that was funded by the Department of Rural Development and Land Reform. So Ian, without further ado.
Thank you, Chair. Afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Establishment of agricultural enterprises for sustainable rural development. Another intervention in collaboration with the Department of Rural Development and the ARC to increase crop production and food security in the country. Just a little quick scenario on the South Africa climate. We are a country with harsh climatic conditions, limited, depleted natural resources, and in the next 2 to 3 decades, we are likely to drop below the benchmark of 1,000 cubic meters of water per person per year. If you look at the present food production scenario in the country, we've got a healthy exportable surplus of basic food in the country until recently regarding staple food. We've always been able to import sufficient food before any real shortages occur in the country. We never featured on the FAO's global information and early warning system as a country in or even approaching a food crisis. And food production in South Africa is diversified, availability of a wide range of food crops in our supermarkets, as you've properly seen. On the other hand, if you look at food security in the country, it's totally a different story. We experience rapidly increasing rates of household food security, especially in the rural areas. Around 40% of the households in food insecurity in the country. Malnutrition remains a considerable problem, especially in the rural areas. Mainly women, children, and elderly are affected. Our policymakers emphasize the importance of agriculture amidst rising concerns about poverty and food security in the country. If you look at our food producers in the country, the farmers, we've got about 30,000 commercial farmers in the country. The numbers are declining annually, although the size of the farms are increasing. They are mainly responsible for national food security and international trade in the country. Apart from that, we have about 300,000 smallholder farmers, mainly in rural production areas, trying to cater for local food security, and then more than 3 million household or backyard gardeners, also trying to cater for household food security. If you look at ARC initiatives, ARC support the entire range of the agricultural sector, from commercial farmers down to household gardens. In collaboration with government departments, tertiary institutions, research institutions, private companies, NGOs, and others. Come back to the agricultural enterprises for sustainable rural development. As already said, it's in a collaboration with the Department of Rural Development to establish sustainable enterprises of several crops. For this presentation, I will focus on the sweet potato enterprises. The main purpose is to address job creation, food insecurity, poverty, rural development, and empowerment of communities. Next to the enterprise development process, we also have a technology development, which is very crucial. in order to support the enterprise development. Research is done there and it includes open field and hydroponic aquaculture production systems, low-cost production systems, specifically aimed at smallholder farmers, mulching, inorganic fertilizer, plant spacing, cultivar development, nutritional value, biological activity, and product development. That is more focused on our indigenous vegetables as well as our medicinal plant enterprises. Then we also include training specifically focused on cultivation practices and financial management. If you look at the key stages in the implementation process, we start with farmer identification, farmer assessment, and then selection of the farmers. As soon as the farmers are selected, we look at soil and water sampling at the specific site of the farmer. Infrastructure assessment. Most of the time, rural farmers don't have any infrastructure and they need to be upgraded. Infrastructure procurement and then obviously market research. As far as the research and development activities listed there, propagation and cultivation, that's where we start with. With the sweet potatoes is not a problem, but with medicinal plants, African leafy vegetables, that information is not available. We need to do research in order to optimize propagation and cultivation with these crops. Then negotiate linking farmers with identified markets as part of the implementation project. You can read there, and then the market linkages, negotiating pricing with identified markets up until evaluation of the enterprise performance. We start with a small hectareage and then increase the hectareage of the farmers as a farmer develop. If you look at the established sweet potato enterprises in the country, this project was initiated 2014-15. During the first year after initiation, 123 sweet potato enterprises were established, of which 70 were sweet potato vine nurseries, where we supply them with virus-indexed material, which they multiply, and then provide disease-free material to the sweet potato growers. Total number of beneficiaries, more than 690, and number of people trained, about 540. Income generated by the sweet potato enterprises. This is only the sweet potato enterprises. Within the first year of implementation, income generated by the farmers, by the enterprises, exceeded 1.4 million rand for in total for the six provinces where it was implemented. Number of jobs created, a total of 470 jobs created, of which the majority was temporary jobs, in-season jobs, but this was only for the first year of implementation. This is just some examples of the sweet potato enterprises. As you can see, it is not homestead. It is semi-commercial to commercial, and that is the only way that we can ensure an economic sustainability. Impact of the sweet potato enterprise development. We've established 17 enterprises, vine nursery enterprises, in five of the provinces. Formation and registration of the 22 member Sweet Potato Vine Grower Association, that's their own association, as a non-profit organization, and an income of 470,000 during the first season, generated by these 70 nurseries. 106 enterprises of sweet potato growers, overall income of 940,000 rand. Overall impact, close to 700 direct beneficiaries from this one project, more than 470 jobs created, started off with small hectareage and will increase with subsequent seasons and years. Just for your information, the sweet potato vine nursery start off with a third of an hectare. Our best farmer's income generated on that third of a hectare during one season was more than 150,000 rand, which is quite remarkable. This is just some examples of the African leafy enterprises. some of the medicinal enterprises, totally a different story. African leafy enterprises, a lot of research need to be done on medicinal enterprises. We'll have to look at the biological activity of these crops. We have to do product development because these products are not freely available in the market. Just a summary of the kind of farmer support that we apply is infrastructure development, soil and water sampling, training on production as well as business skills, demonstrations, input support very important, and then monitoring and linking farmers to the formal market. Then to go back to household gardening for food security, remember there were the three different groups. We have an easy erectable tunnel, 5 by 12 square meters, with a customized dripper system of about 60 square meters inside the shade net structure and about 40 square meters outside, which is sufficient to supply a family of six with a nutritious meal for more than 6 months. Then we also have the bag system for smallholder farmers with limited access to good soil. The bags that we use are the typical maize meal bags that they have, lots of them, and we use a compost medium inside with holes, and they can produce a large amount of small, mainly leafy crops. Some of the products from an orange fresh sweet potato, flour on the left-hand side, bread, as well as scones. Products from the Moringa, I see those of you who visited the exhibition would have seen some of these products there. Other ARC initiatives include, in collaboration with the CSIR and Nestle, we recently, last year during November, launched a 2-minute noodle of Morocco, which is amaranth. And we started with semi-commercial plantings, 5 hectares in Northwest and the Eastern Cape each, for production. I can just mention, when it was launched, within 2 days, everything was sold out on the markets. Other ARC initiatives from other institutes include conservation agriculture, rainwater harvesting, biodigester technology for small-scale farmers from the Institute of Soil, Climate and Water. The crop-based approach of ARC WOPI promotes home gardens with orange colored fruit and vegetables in order to supply fresh micronutrients. I said there in the beginning, vitamin A deficiency, a major problem in South Africa. The integrated village renewal program of the Institute of Tropical and Subtropical Crops. This is an example of a long-term rural development program in the Eastern Cape. I think it's more than 15 years ongoing and still doing better. In conclusion, what is important as far as enterprise development is concerned? The selection of the crop, the site, and the beneficiaries is very, very important. That's crucial. You can't plant the wrong crop in the wrong area, and you can also not engage with the wrong beneficiaries who are not committed. Beneficiaries must be involved as from the start. Training and mentoring is crucial, and it must be ongoing, because the majority of these people are not that literate, they're not familiar with agricultural science, and they need to be mentored at least 4 to 5 years to get independent on themselves. Linkings of the farmers with the service providers, agribusinesses, beyond community boundaries, that is for markets outside the village. Integrated plans, sustainable development cannot depend on agriculture alone. It should be integrated with other infrastructure development like roads, etc. We must clearly distinguish between homestead intervention for homestead gardens, which is based on self-sustainment, and smallholder farming and commercial that will create income. What we normally do, we start with the homestead or the smaller people, and those with potential and interest develop into smallholder and then into commercial farmers. It's a long-term commitment. Funding need to be available. Commitment must be there at least 7 to 8 years before it can be sustainable. It does have, it clearly showed that it have a major impact on food security, job creation, and income generation. Acknowledgements of some of the departments that we work with. And in conclusion, I can just say that poverty and food insecurity is man-made, and it must be resolved through man-made resolutions. Please visit the exhibitions and attend the site visit just after the season, the session where you will see some of these in the field. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you very much for a really good overview of the work that is being done. And you can already see that only after 1 year there is major impact made.
We have that in August to take care of it. also have different growing seasons. In the warmer areas, you can change the planting season, of, especially if it's a frost-free area, to plant in a different time slot. And then the price is always much higher because it's not the normal time.
Unfortunately, there's no time for more questions, but during the trials and visits, there will be opportunities for you to further engage.
She mentioned that I come from the Small Grain Institute, and I tried to put the figure in there. You can see that's a Small Grain Institute and is situated in Bethlehem. And I'm going to tell you more about the processes that we followed to implement molecular breeding for disease resistance in wheat. And this is going to be sort of similar with what you had earlier this morning when it was presented that most of the performance in cattle is basically coming from the genes. So again, even in wheat and most of all the other plants, and again in humans and all the organisms, the performance is mostly depicted from the genes that are present in there. So the approach that we are using here is basically going in and trying to select the genes themselves, and also at the end of the day, phenotype that and then see what is involved in resistance. So the team that I'm involved in is responsible for characterizing the germplasm, and this is the germplasm that we have in our germplasm bank, and then we use a variety of tools. We use diagnostic markers, and we also use the phenotype to see the expression of the genes. And once we are able to identify the lines that have desirable genes, then we use them in crosses, and we cross them with adapted material. These are the material that we get from the breeders, or it could be the material that comes from the recent cultivars, and seeing that one of the cultivars that is recent has some deficiencies. It could be deficiencies in terms of disease resistance. It could be deficiencies in terms of quality. It could be deficiencies in terms of drought tolerance. And then once we do that, then we develop our germplasm, and then we release the material to the breeders. And the breeders that we release the material to, it's all the breeders in South Africa. There are three main breeding programs, wheat breeding programs. There is Sensaco, there is PANA, there is also ARC. And I can tell you that the germplasm that we send them, they are very excited to get some of that germplasm to make sure that they drive their breeding programs. And what I want to show you now is how do we feed with the efforts that breeders do. Well, the normal routine process that breeders do, they take the germplasm and then they develop varieties with that germplasm. And then the route that they normally take, you can see, it's a long process before. It takes years and years. And some of you who worked with crops, they have probably know that it takes 10 to 20 years to release a cultivar from the germplasm that you start with. But using molecular tools, and I'm not going to go into the details what those molecular tools are. You heard earlier about some of the molecular tools that we explained in the presentation on animals. But we try to shorten that and not to take all those many years and just move directly from using, have the breeders use the improved germplasm, and then they release the cultivars that they want. And the other version of that will be, if you have a population or you've created a population from whatever sources that you have. So if you use molecular markers, you have high chances of selecting lines that have genes that you want in a shorter space of time. And you can even do this at an early generations before you do further courses. And you move directly, then you have those. But if you rely only on phenotypic selections, it becomes so difficult for you to select the individuals directly. At the early generations, you have to go through several generations, and it takes many years before you can get there. So this is just an indication of how molecular tools can help. And of course, depending on whatever crops you have, you can modify the application of molecular markers to expedite the breeding process or to expedite the transfer of desirable genes into the lines that you are interested in. And so how do we do this? I'm just going to go very quickly how we do it. We take the germplasm from the from our national small grain germplasm bank, and then the germplasm that we have, then we characterize it. What are the genes that are present in this germplasm? Are these genes for resistance? Are these genes for whatever? And then we use molecular markers, and we also use some screening tools. We get the rust, if it's a rust, and then we inoculate all these assertions with the rust. If it's a Fusarium mid blight, we inoculate it with Fusarium mid blight. If it's a take-all, if it's whatever kind of disease we have, then we inoculate. Then we can be able to see the expression of resistance. And then if not, then we can use molecular markers. And once we identify the lines that are resistant or that will have the kinds of genes that we are looking for, then we use that as the source and then backcross it into some of the lines that we have. Either it could be the line that is being sent to us by the breeders who want us to put specific genes, or it's a line that is sort of very adapted that we see. Then we can sort of try to put as many genes as possible. And then once we make those crosses, then we screen the progenies. And then the progenies can be backcrossed several times into the background that is selected by the breeder, or the background that we sort of feel that is very good. And then from there, we try to confirm in the field, because just using the marker only is not going to help. You have to use the marker and then take it to the field and then see the expression. And then we use breeders and we use some of the collaborators to help in doing this. And one rule that we have had earlier this morning, and then I'm going to mention that again now, is that once if you put in junk, you're going to get junk out. So we try by all the means not to put in any junk. So the germplasm that we have almost more than 18,000 accessions of small grains, but my main focus now is going to be, we have several projects on wheat, and then I'm going to talk mostly on rust. But then I can show you, you can see the nurseries that we have there. And we look for a variety of traits, like I mentioned before. We look for pre-harvest sprouting, that's up in the top there. We look for some other traits that are involved in bread-making quality, because in wheat, bread-making quality and the quality, the end-use quality, is one of the major criteria that is being used to release the cultivars. And then we look for other disease resistance and for aluminium tolerance and for Russian wheat aphids resistance that I'm showing there. But I'm going to narrow all of my presentation now on diseases only. And just to make an example here, we have a project that looks at developing lines that have multiple resistant genes for rust. So rust is caused by three different pathogens. And you have a leaf rust as a disease. You have a stripe rust, which is also known as a yellow rust, which is also another disease. And we have a stem rust, which is another disease. And then for each of these diseases, we have more than 50 to 60 genes that have been identified. And a lot of efforts have gone into identifying molecular markers for each of these resistant genes. And our team has played a very important role also at the international level to release some of the markers, or even publish some of the markers that are linked to some of these genes. So the efforts on this project is to try, like I said, is to try to bring as many genes as possible into one line or into one cultivars, and then send that to breeders. And if you put the lines that have multiple genes in the field, they have a high level of resistance to almost zero infection. You don't see the disease at all. And then the reason that we are doing that is that if you have multiple genes for resistance, stem rust, yellow rust, and leaf rust, then the pathogen does not have a chance of mutating. It has to mutate for probably two or three genes at one time, which is actually less likely to happen. And once we have those lines that have multiple disease-resistant genes, we can send them to breeders, and then they use them for crosses, or they can release them as varieties. And we also try to make sure that we screen a lot of entries from our germplasm bank into different sites. We have three sites in Bethlehem, in the Free State, in Sidara, KZN, and Tagahook in Western Cape. And we evaluated in the last year alone, we evaluated more than 3,000 accessions in all those locations. And for that project on rust alone, I'm just indicating the four lines up here. These are the lines that were developed mostly using molecular markers. And at the end of the at the end of using molecular markers, we were able to put them in the field to see how they react to rust. And I can tell you that they all showed zero infection type, just because of the two main genes here, that gene SR25 and SR26. Were initially not used by many breeders because they were linked to some deleterious genes or deleterious effects on yield or quality. So the sources that we used here do not have any deleterious effects on quality or on yield. So we released this material to the breeders, and breeders were very excited to see that most of this material does not have any effect on yield and on quality. And then the other lines that we released to the breeders, this one we used both traditional procedures of screening for the progenies for all the rust every generations, and at the end of the day, we screened with markers to determine if the progenies that we had, which are the five lines that I'm showing you here, they have all these genes for resistance to the tree rust. You have a yellow rust there, you have a leaf rust, and you also have a stem rust. And the material was evaluated for yield and also quality, and we did select all these five out of a large number of lines that were evaluated. And most of these five lines, actually all the five lines, have a very good and acceptable quality. And you can see the yields of those lines in the field. So the other example I want to make is Fusarium head blight. We have developed a very good screening procedure for Fusarium head blight. And we have two locations in Bethlehem and in Sidara where we evaluate most of our entries. Some of the entries, we get them from CIMIT. CIMIT distribute the annual nurseries for scape or for Fusarium head blight. And then the disease, you can see it on the head. You have a bleached head mostly. And I'm just showing the figures there. This is what you see in the field when you inoculate and try to evaluate for Fusarium head blight. So on this slide, what I'm showing is the crosses that were made with different sources, and then what genes were targeted. And these genes that were targeted there, they give a very good resistance to Fusarium head blight. And we used markers that would that were linked to those genes. And we're able to screen the numbers here and then the number of plants that had the genes that were targeted. So the other efforts is on generating material that could be used to do some molecular studies. We have students working on these activities for nested association mapping panels, trying to find new sources of resistance and the genes and find more markers. We have for Fusarium head blight, for rust, and then we have some neoantigenic lines that we have developed for all these leaf rust resistant genes. We're trying to develop some CASPR markers for each of those genes, and then we have made some progress with the LR2 locus, and we have identified LR15, which is the gene that's known for a long time. But people thought that it was a different gene, but what we discovered is that it's another allele and should be renamed as LR2D. So one last example that I want to give is the example that actually made all of us very proud, and it was the use of molecular markers for the rust-resistant genes, and then try to bring all those rust-resistant genes with the resistance for Russian wheat aphids. And then the resistance for Russian wheat aphids was mainly done by conventional way because we don't have markers at all for resistance to Russian wheat aphids. Our team is putting efforts to make sure that we develop some good markers for Russian wheat aphids. But so the end product of this project was that we had 10 lines that had combination of all these desirable genes. And then the lines, there's a paper that document all these 10 lines, and the seed was sent to CIMIT and USDA. And most of them, they have a very good quality when you assess them. And with that, I would like to thank you for listening.
Thank you for a very interesting discussion and presentation, and also showing the value that technology has in fast-tracking our breeding programs and getting cultivars to farmers sooner. Can I request that the people that have questions maybe allowed to do one or two questions?
Thanks for an interesting talk. I just want to find out how stable is the resistance vis-a-vis abiotic factors. In nematode resistance, the resistance is normally lost when the temperatures go up. I wanted to find out in terms of drought, in terms of these high temperatures that we are experiencing, how stable would be your resistance?
Thank you. I see that you know all the traits that you are losing are resistance. I think it's important for some humid areas, but you know most of the world is subjected to drought. And today in the morning they are talking about drought resistance. How effective such a method can be used for drought resistance and other quantitative traits that we are need for that, like heat and others.
Do you have, or maybe you are studying the Uganda rays, do you have some varieties which are resistant to Uganda rays?
Okay, so I'll start with the question that was asked now.
In South Africa, we have about four of the races that are within the Eugenian lineage. So, and we have been using them to screen most of our material. We do have cultivars and even some germplasm that are resistant. Actually, the four lines that I showed that have SR25, SR26, and SR89, those lines, they are all, they show almost zero infection type to the UG99 race pool. And then the other question about drought. Well, my talk was about disease resistance. So within a short space of time, I can only talk about disease, talk about all the others. We have two students. I have about 13 students now, but two students are working on drought tolerance. And we have a lot of efforts that are put into drought. And you can use molecular tools. There are genes that have been cloned to be responsible for drought tolerance, and we are trying to use some of those genes to find homologs in wheat, and that we can sort of use what we call genome editing to sort of try to edit the genes that are homologs and see their expressions. And of course, we have other different approaches that we are implementing for drought tolerance, where we use the existing germplasm and put it under drought stress and look at which ones can resist
or can be tolerant to stand to count. Of course, count is very subjective, depending on what level of stress are you imposing on the plants, and we have been debating that a lot with students, and they have one of the students has written a very good manuscript, and it's published. I think it's coming out in next month or this year of next month or this month of Journal of Interpretive Agriculture on breeding for drought tolerance in wheat. So the other questions about the resistance, if it is stable, well, most of the genes that I showed there, they show a very stable resistance, but there are some of the genes, for example, the SR6 gene, which I happened to work on with long time ago, it's temperature sensitive. So under high temperature, so the gene is not effective. Under a moderate temperature, it's very effective. So, but most of the genes are very, very stable across high temperatures and even low temperatures.
Thank you very much, Toy, and he's still around. So, during the field trials, you're more than welcome to ask him more questions. Let me now introduce Professor Bongani Ndemba. He's from our Institute, Liefverbay Institute, all the way from Stellenbosch in the Cape region. So if you enjoy wines, talk to him. He will talk to us about the housestone and palm fruit varieties from South Africa, help to build the industry in our country.
Thank you very much, Dr. Fender. Thanks for the introduction, so I won't repeat that. This morning, Mr. Mongwe, when he was giving instruction, he said, enjoy the show, I think if I heard correctly. So I'll try and keep the talk entertaining as best as I can, and with colorful pictures. Some of you don't know stone and palm, so I just put two examples there. An example of a famous palm fruit is apple, and stone fruits are those fruit that have a big pip inside. So keep the date in mind. Today is the 7th of April. It will become very important next. I take you to a journey, Sonia said, enjoy the journey, to take you back to how did this industry start in South Africa at this current nature as we know it. Those lines that you're seeing there are logs of ship that have been crisscrossing the Indian and the Atlantic Ocean over the last 350 years. There was a company that started from Holland called a Dutch East India Company, which had to go from Europe to India, and they had to pass South Africa, as you can see in the map there. And Cape Town, or the Cape of Good Hope, was one of the points where they had to dock. And over time, it became very important to use that as a refreshment station. A young man by the name of Jan van Riebeeck was the commander of those three ships. If you studied in South Africa, you had to memorize their name. I don't remember them, but at least this talk rejuvenated my memory. They docked on the 6th of April, 1652. And the following day, Oom Jan became the commander of the Cape. Very nice. And one of his enterprises, which he identified, was the business, because now it's not only his company that had to go via there. But before we talk about business, let's just take a very quick historical journey. 7th of April, 1652, 17th of April, 1662. That's the first time he harvested the first apple from the trees he planted the year or two after his arrival. That's about 10 years. Talking about patience. And then, now these are scientists from my institute. Now you skip few hundred years, I think that's about 360 years later, 17th of April, 2013. It is linking a journal that was written by Jan van Riebeeck on the 17th of April, where he said, heavy drizzle in the morning and a strong northwesterly wind blowing from the sea. Today, the first two ripe Dutch apples were picked from the company's nursery. they came from a little tree that was about 5 feet high. And that apple was called a vein apple. And on the 17th of April in 2016, Kashif Sukar there is one of our fruit evaluators. I'm not sure whether it was the same farm, but let's for entertainment's sake say it was the same. So if you look at the time, it's about 360 years later. So 360 is a circumference. We have gone almost a full circle. Remember, he was putting this in his diary. So the Elgin Graboa, which is the small newspaper in Graboa in the Elgin region, they were writing this on their Facebook page. So that is the age of Facebook versus the age of the journal's entry. Now, you start from 1562 to 1892. That's about 200 years later, 230 years later. An English gentleman by the name of Percy Molteno, he saw a business enterprise. And remember that the English arrived in 1820, around there, about 200 years after the Dutch. He saw a business opportunity. That is one of the typical ships that were now harvesting apples for shipping to Europe, because obviously after the R&D was done to see that apples can keep in the container for about 3 months, people were able to ship fruit from South Africa to London. And this is what it is. And I couldn't find an example of the old ship, but that's a container leaving the dock of Cape Town going somewhere. Unfortunately, around the same time, about a few years later, there was a big war in South Africa, 1899 to 1902, between the English, who came later, and the Dutch, who came a few years, a couple of hundred years before that. That interrupted that trade for a bit, because now there is economics. There is a lot of competition who is supposed to own South Africa, so to speak. But the story is long, but as I was doing this research, there is a gentleman by the name of John Tengo Jabavu. But I don't have time to talk about him today, but keep in mind there is an association between these two gentlemen, Percy and John, which I hope to share with you another day. But let me quickly run into my talk before I run out of time. Oh, I've got another 10 minutes. This is the institute where I come from. It's called Institute for Deciduous Fruits and Oenology, which was established, obviously now, to support that growing industry. And in fact, in the Cape of Good Hope, they were not only producing fruit, but also vegetables, which links to earlier talks and the theme of this institute as well. Just to quickly move on, we work on cultivar development, horticulture, plant protection, post-harvest and wine technology, soil and water science, viticulture, as well as other technologies, including proteomics. And I didn't see this slide today, and I'm glad I put it. This is the map of South Africa. And all those red dots that you're seeing there are either ARC farms, research stations, or some sites that we do our work in. So you can see the ARC is well positioned and has got a very good footprint in South Africa to do the research that we do, which is why we are able to collaborate with institutes and do trials all across all the geographic zones of South Africa. As you know, that we've got a very diverse climatic diversity as the country. Oh, in addition to the research that we do, we have to keep some of the material, some of the national assets, for government. So we are contracted by government also to do what we call gene banks of some of the material so that they are available for the next 300 years for people to do their work. Now, this is a typical work that we do after we've crossed the apples or pears or peaches. We have to evaluate them. We have to see how they keep, how they look, whether the customers want. And those people that are there, some of them are curious people, some of them are traders, some of them, they represent growers. So they are coming at the institute during the harvesting season after post-storage tests to come and test different varieties of our peaches. And if they are promising ones, then we register the plant breeders' rights, and then we own the intellectual property, and we market it. I'm halfway through my talk. I hope you're still getting my drift. So just to summarize all of this, I couldn't give all the examples. But believe it or not, the ARC is the biggest single holder of what we call plant breeders' rights, whether they are from grains, from fruit, not sure about animals, but I got that statement from good authority that we own the IP of the agricultural material. On our side, at least now that number has gone to over 130 different fruit cultivars that we own as part of our IP. And in 2015 alone, we released four new apple cultivars that came from many, many years. And sometimes that period takes over 15 to 20 years to develop a new cultivar. I won't go into details what they are, but you know that we've got apples, pears, peaches, nectarines, plums, apricots, table grapes, and so on and so on. But I promised you that I'll be doing pictures. So this is what they look like. In the space of about 7 years, between 2007 and 2014, we released 45 new cultivars, and here they are. We're not only producing material just for fresh eating. Some of the stone fruits in particular, they are bred specifically for drying as well as for canning qualities. Believe it or not, there are different techniques and different breeding objectives for getting something ready for eating, as well as those that can keep in a can, in a bottle, or that can dry properly and nicely. These are some of the colorful peaches that are dried, and they are sold. You know, obviously after drying, you can keep them as long as you can until you open the packet. This is a very interesting point of the collaboration between us and industry. The ARC owns over 98% of all the cultivars that are currently commercialized for these purposes, drying and canning. So without the ARC, the South African canning and drying industry cannot exist. So we have to look after each other, you know, if they, you know, we have something to bargain with. And they know that if they keep on funding us, then we can do research that can benefit them, as well as vice versa. Just because I couldn't go through all of them, I thought I will give you some few examples of these industries that we work with. And we were discussing yesterday about how is agriculture or agricultural producers organized in South Africa. They are organized in associations. They used to be trust and different evolutions, but now for my institute, I work with, for example, let me come back to Caldefco. I'll start with the second one. The South African Pear and Apple and Pear Producers Association called SAPA. And we've got the stone fruit guys called SASPA. We've got a table grape fellows called SATI, Canning Fruit Producers Association, as well as dried association people. That is the five producers trust. We as the ARC licensed a company called, or an organization called Caldefco, to do the marketing and licensing of our varieties. Because we can't be good in everything. We are very good in R&D, but you need a specialist to do the marketing of our varieties, both in South Africa as well as overseas. So that is the job that was given to Caldefco for the last 10 years. And on top of that, HodGrow is the mouthpiece of all these industries. Their job is to negotiate with government, collect levies, and distribute those income levies to these industries. And they decide on how to spend that money. And we persuade them all the time to spend more money on R&D, and we persuade them to spend that money at the ARCs. We're not always successful, but we're doing our best. There is HodGrow Science to look after research, and there is also WineTech for collecting levies that come from wine sales. Now, I'm gonna run a few slides on just to show off to you some of our IP. And you will see that you know, coming from 350 years ago, the ARC in South Africa is becoming more Afrocentric. Some of the latest low-chill apple cultivars have got the Afri flavor with them. We've got, for example, Afri Star, Afri Glow, Afri Rose, apple varieties, and many others that you can see in front of you named with some nice colorful marketing trademarks, both here in South Africa as well as you can find them in Sainsbury's or Safeways in the UK, and yeah. If you look at our table grape varieties, these are their names. If you come to my institute during harvesting season, you're likely to get a bowl of these in my office while we're having the meeting. Very nice and beautiful. Some of them are still selections. They are not registered yet. We're running out of time. We've got a minute to go, but I'm almost done. But one that I can point out to you is the Sandella. Sandella was released, I think, not long ago, a few years ago. And that name, Sandella, is inspired by Nelson Mandela. I have another story to talk about Nelson Mandela and one of the farms, because maybe let me finish the business first and see if I have a few seconds. The royalty income from our IP between 2007 and 2017 has grown, as you can see, almost exponentially through this partnership that I told you about between us and industry. Just in summary, 80,000 hectares are planted with deciduous fruits by about 2,000 farmers, creating over 100,000 permanent jobs, plus obviously the dependence of those employees. 10 billion rands is the GDP drawn by the industry. That's, if you don't, not familiar with the rands, close to 1 billion US dollars per annum. And you can see the proportions of what is consumed locally as well as what we export, 45 to 55%. And most of this work is done in the eastern, in the Western Cape, but the low chill apple varieties are giving us opportunity to expand further. Now, emerging farmers and the rural development is the flavor of the future, because we need to expand. There is a deciduous fruit development chamber, which is the empowerment chamber of this trust. And the message from today is no one left behind. So we need to find means to empower the emerging farmers. It's not as easy as it is for vegetable people, but we're trying, because to grow an apple tree, you remember from Jan van Riebeeck time, you need at least 10 years. So this is us, and that is my last slide with our new crop of researchers for the future. Thank you very much.
Of two viruses, the maize chlorotic motile virus and any of the members of the Potiviridae family that infect cereals, which you call it as one of these is a sugarcane mosaic virus. When the disease is combined infection of maize plants, when it happens by these two viruses, these are the typical symptoms, and slowly it leads to entire necrosis, leading to the death of the plant. This is a farmer that we visited as early as in 2012 January, and the disease broke out in the Bomet County. This is what she harvested from her previous season of half an acre. That's it. And this is the state of her present crop season, of her present season in 2012, almost yielding nothing. She had to sell her cattle, she had to stop making children go to school. The disease is such a devastating disease. if it affects at the vegetative stage, almost 80% to 100% crop loss. Why did it happen? We'll come to that later. But these are the two causal organisms, the main sclerotic martin virus and the sugarcane mosaic virus. These viruses are transmitted by insect vectors, mainly aphids, thrips, and leaf beetles. And we also know which among the thrips, which among these aphids transmit these two pathogens. But what is more disturbing here is that this is also travels mostly through contaminated seed. So it is not the insects that are flowing from Kenya to Uganda, Tanzania, Rwanda, Ethiopia. It's the contaminated seed which has gone into these countries, rapidly spreading the disease. Please bear in mind, I am using the word contamination. I'm not saying transmission. Transmission means the virus has to be literally present within the seed, whereas contamination means the virus could be very well present on the outer layer of the seed, that is on the pericarp. So what is the impact of MLN? 23% yield loss in Kenya, estimated by CIMIC socioeconomists over the last 3-4 years. Almost 0.3 million metric tons annually, and estimated to be about $188 million of maize only in Kenya itself. If you combine this effect from all the Eastern African countries, it could go down almost to 700-800 million overall. What is important is not only the farmer yields very little, almost zero, but if it happens at the later stages and MLN devastates the field, what you reap from that particular crop is almost like this. Is it edible? No. It's not even edible to human beings or for animals. You can look at the molds that have taken place on the crop, and typically aflatoxins can even go inside. So it's not just the lack of harvest, even the harvest that you get could be severely impaired with other pathogens. But MLN, or maize lethal necrosis, is not a new disease to the international scientific community. The corn lethal necrosis, the CLN, was a disease that was reported in Peru, in Kansas, in Hawaii, as early as in 1970s. 1973 was the first time when corn lethal necrosis was first reported in US. So why is it so devastating now in Africa when it has happened for almost 40, 50 years? It has been there in US. There are two or three main reasons. One, the conducive environment. Wherever we have this bimodal rainfall pattern, the farmers tend to grow maize after maize after maize after maize. That's a very conducive cycle for the virus to proliferate. The second one is that somebody is harvesting his maize, somebody's crop is in the knee-high stage, and somebody is just planting. That's the way in which most villages in Eastern Africa grow maize too. So this lack of synchronized planting, continuous cropping of maize, is a very ideal situation for the virus to proliferate. Secondly, this particular disease, as I said, is already not only seed contaminated. The third most important thing, very, very few germplasm out there carry resistance to the one of the pathogens, that is NCMV. So even in the vast maize gene pool that CIMIC has, there are extremely few sources of resistance to the maize sclerotic martin virus. That's the deadliest among these two viruses. Whereas sugarcane mosaic virus has been there in Africa since almost 4 to 5 decades. It's not such a major pathogen, but it's the MCMV, introduction of MCMV. How did it get introduced? Unfortunately, it got introduced from Southeast Asia, especially when these virus isolates have been sequenced and homology compared. There is almost 98% sequence homology with a Thai Chinese isolate of MCMV. And that has come through specialty corn, that is sweet corn, baby corn, seed that has been grown in the Naivasha region in Kenya from China. And that's the more major reason why MCMV got introduced. That's the unfortunate part of it. So we need to be extremely careful. in terms of MLM diagnostics. Coming to the, what did we do when this virus, when this disease broke out? CIMIT immediately got into partnership with Calro, and we established a dedicated MLM screening facility, a quarantine screening facility at Naivasha. Why did we choose Naivasha? This is a hotspot. Already the pathogens are there. So you do not wish to introduce the pathogens into a new area. So this is a dedicated 20-hectare screening facility that was established at the Calro Center in Naivasha with almost no commercial farming, all 3 to 4 kilometers anywhere near this. There are three major greenhouses which we use, one to multiply the maize sclerotic multivirus, another to multiply the sugarcane mosaic virus, and third one to screen individually the germplasm for any of these viruses, besides 17 hectares of open screening facility. This is a drone photograph that we took recently. It shows the beautiful facility. And this is the Lake Naivasha. And there is absolutely no way farmers will get affected even through these facilities. What you see here is a patch. Can you see this patch? This is how the temperate germplasm from US, when you introduce and screen against this African isolate of MCMV, respond to battlefield. Almost nothing you can get out of this. So that means even the MCMV resistant maize that is grown in US is not resistant to MCMV of Africa. That's the unfortunate part of it. That's because this particular isolate is much more aggressive. How did US control this particular disease? There's a typical maize-soyabean cycle. Soyabean cannot transfer the MCMV. MCMV can only go through cereals. And secondly, there is a harsh winter cycle. That harsh winter cycle kills the pathogen. So wherever there is only one cycle of maize followed by a legume with a harsh winter cycle, MLN is not such a big issue. But wherever you have a continuous cropping of maize, there is obviously a huge risk involved. Over the last 3 years, CIMIT screened almost 65,000 entries of germplasm. 65,000 entries is not a joke, almost going up to 120,000 rows of germplasm entries over the each of these seasons. The bad news, close to 90% of the materials, you can see all these yellow materials are highly susceptible to MLN. That is combined infection, where each and every plant is challenged with the virus, the two viruses. But amidst this devastation, you can still see there are some entries which are absolutely green and carrying no symptom whatsoever. That means at least 10% of this CIMIT germplasm offer resistance to MLN. And that's a good news, because from the 10%, you can rebuild an entire pipeline. And that pipeline has been rebuilt in the last 2 years. This facility is not only for screening germplasm of CIMIT. We screen germplasm from the National Agricultural Research Systems in sub-Saharan Africa, as well as from the private sector, all the big companies that are presently operating in Africa, as well as the small and medium enterprise seed companies. They grow their entries to find out whether anything can offer resistance to MLN. So they are doing very proactive breeding for resistance to MLN. Unfortunately, they are not finding much resistance there. And we have literally shipped hundreds of germplasm to each of these major seed companies too, so that they can rebuild their breeding programs for MLN resistance. I would like ARC Africa to also screen the germplasm here, Kingston, which is very, very important. We never know, these pathogens do not have any passports. They don't require any visas, so they can go from one country to another country. We do need to have a proactive breeding for this major disease. Okay, this is how typically some of the most popular inbred lines developed by CIMIT, they respond. These are the best drought-tolerant, disease-resistant materials, all except MLN. If you challenge these inbred lines with MLN, this is what is going to happen. Whereas you do have some very promising sources of resistance not only from the CMYCs lowland tropical germplasm from Latin America, but also from, this is one of the best lines from Thailand, Kasets at University in Thailand, KS523-6. And so these are the, there are some excellent trait donors now available. You need to get these materials, you need to use them in breeding programs and transfer MLN resistance. Within 3 years, we are also successful in identifying first generation MLN tolerant hybrids and released in 3 countries, Uganda, Tanzania, and Kenya. That's a remarkable progress. I don't think many institutions worldwide can do that. Within 3-4 years after a disease epidemic breaking out, you have 5 MLN tolerant hybrids that are already released for commercial cultivation. And how do these hybrids perform? Look at these tolerant hybrids versus susceptible commercial checks. So if you go to the Naivasha facility, you can very clearly see the difference between the tolerant hybrid and the susceptible hybrid. We also are screening land races against these pathogens at our Mexico facility, screening almost 1,200 maize land races accessions, including some of these like from Caribbean. You have to climb ladders to go and pollinate these materials. So this is how tall they are. But there are some very promising sources of tolerance amongst these Caribbean, Venezuelan, Peruvian, and Mexican landrace accessions. So we are using these landrace accessions to further enhance our resistance. Okay, these are our second generation MLN resistant hybrids. I deliberately use the word resistant versus tolerance because if you take ELISA readings of these hybrids, they are not only good for yield, but they do not carry much virus titer, even after artificial inoculation. That means they have kept the virus titers to a minimal levels and with absolutely no yield penalty compared to the best commercial checks. We have almost 15 second generation CMYC-derived MLN hybrids now presently under national performance trials in Kenya, Tanzania, and Uganda. How do they yield? Look at the yield of these second generation hybrids versus a susceptible commercial check, which yields nothing. So that means not only the plant is healthy, green, but also yields extremely well. You take them to the high MLN disease pressure conditions in Tanzania under natural farmers conditions. This is how the resistant hybrid performs versus one of the best commercial hybrids that is grown in Tanzania, so which is devastated against the disease. So under such conditions, a resistant hybrid can easily offer 5 to 6 tons per hectare compared to 0 to 1 ton per hectare of the susceptible commercial checks. Okay, this is the coded means second generation hybrid, 52 of them tested, 5.7 tons per hectare. Our first generation MLN hybrids, that means not deliberately bred, but these are chance discoveries in our already available germplasm, 4.9 tons per hectare, and commercial checks, 2.1 tons per hectare. We have also discovered QTLs for MLN resistance recently, especially 2 major QTLs, one on chromosome 6 and another on chromosome 3. This is really a big effect QTL on chromosome 6. Okay, final, very quick, 2 minutes. We need to tackle the MLN challenge on diverse fronts. Breeding is only one part of the story. We have to strengthen the MLN surveillance and diagnostic capacity, effective agronomic interventions, cropping system diversification is a must. Creating awareness at various levels, phytosanitary testing and safe exchange of germplasm, and MLN pathogen-free commercial seed production and exchange, and managing the insect vectors and virus cohorts. That's why we started a community of practice among the national plant protection organizations in these 8 countries right now. 5 are MLN endemic, and 3 are non-endemic countries, but there is a lot of commercial maize seed produced and exchanged. The purpose of this MLN phytosanitary community of practice is to create and ensure a structure that allows stakeholders to promote the best practices in controlling the spread of and impact of MLN, build common capabilities, and share knowledge and best practices across borders. this is today's South Africa. You look at the number of companies operating, you add South Africa, it becomes even more important. These are the countries which produces and exchanges large volumes of commercial seed to all over sub-Saharan Africa. We need to protect these countries from this major epidemic. We have even brought out brochures, technical brochures on MLN pathogen diagnosis and how to produce and exchange MLN pathogen-free seed. And this is extremely important. Seed companies need to be really made aware about the need to produce, put up voluntary control programs, train their key staff, and make sure that every commercial seed lot they produce and exchange is free from MLN pathogens. Many thanks to Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, USAID, and all the donors who support our work on MLN, the partners, especially the NAS and private sector partners, colleagues from advanced research institutions in US, and last but not the least, CIMIT colleagues. And thank you very much, the organizers, for giving this opportunity. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, Prasanna, for telling us about this devastating disease and also strategies how to combat it. And it's also thank you for your partnership with the AR